Thank you, Tishani, for those wonderful poems. The next panel discussion, Singapore Story, The Search for an Identity, will be moderated by Dr. Meira Chiang. Dr. Meira Chiang is one of Singapore's most well-known authors. Her book, A Different Sky, was acclaimed globally and was included in Oprah Winfrey's recommended reading list. She was the chairperson of the Singapore Literature Prize in 2012, and she also served as the chair for the Commonwealth Writers' Prize for the region of Southeast Asia and the South Pacific. Joining her on the panel today are Suchen Christian Lim. In 1992, she won the inaugural Singapore Literature Prize for her novel, Fistful of Colors. Her works of fiction draw on history of Singapore, Malaysia, and China. A short story from The Lies That Build a Marriage was made into a film for national television. Her most recent novel, The River's Song, was launched during the Singapore Writers Festival in 2013 and in London in 2014. And finally, joining us on the panel is Claire Chiang. She's Singapore's leading entrepreneur, activist, and author. She was Singapore's Woman of the Year in 1998 and is a former Member of Parliament. She is also the co-founder and senior vice president of Banyan Tree Holdings. She's also the co-author of the book Stepping Out, The Making of Chinese Entrepreneurs, which received the National Council Book Award and was produced as a television drama series in Singapore, which won 5 broadcast awards. I shall now pass the floor to Dr. Meira Chiang.
I don't know if this is working, you can hear me. Claire and Suchen, welcome. This year is the 50th anniversary of Singapore, as we all know. So it's very appropriate, I think, that we're talking about identity today. Recently, I read a poem by Lee Zupeng, yes, which began, my country and my people are neither here nor there. And to me, this resonated greatly because I'm someone who is made up of all kinds of ethnic and cultural bits and pieces, to such an extent that I'm really, really neither here nor there. So I've recently come to rest in Singapore, and I'm very happy to find a country that is, in a sense, neither here nor there, made up of so many ethnic and cultural different mosaic of different things. So I'm very happy to rest here and find my identity in that kind of checkerboard society. But I do wonder for Suchen and Claire what the issue of identity means as a real Singaporean. I'm a very new Singaporean, so I have a very different view of it than you two. And also in your writings, both of you have examine that identity. So Chen, would you like to go first on that?
Well, since this is the 50th year, can you? I think we read a lot about identity in the press these days, and normally it's most of the time it's the men talking about identity with a big I. And the ruling party. So, but for me, in my writing, I explore identity with a smaller to do with the individual. I think all writers, somebody said on this panel, writers are perverse. So you go slightly to the left side of things or to the right side of things. Everybody going to the right, we go to the left, you know, and look at other things. I grew up on on both sides of the causeway. So when I came over here, it was a very different Singapore, you know, rat infested, you know, slum area and so on. But now that I've been here for a long time, I look back and I remember that when I first came, I was part of Malaysia. And then 3 years later, we were not. And I was somebody without a state. You said you're neither here nor there. I was stateless. I was stateless for more than 10 years because in those days, for anyone wanting to be a Singaporean, to acquire citizenship, we have to live here 10 years of unbroken stay. I couldn't even go over across the causeway to Johor Bahru for satay. If that happened, then my calculation would start all over again from day one. So I think probably I was forced to marry. The rule is that if you marry and for 2 years, after 2 years or 3 years, I can't remember, and you then you can start applying. That means you can only start. After 10 years, you can only start applying. So it depends a whole lot of things on your qualifications, on whether you are a graduate or a secondary school student, and the usual thing. So it was quite traumatic. And partly, when I was in secondary two, I think, I was given a scholarship. Then when they found out I was, oh, you're from Malaysia, 6 months later, they took it away. I was 14 years old, and it was really traumatic. They took away your scholarship. So that was my start, my attempt to be Singaporean, and my parents' attempt. So I was stateless for, I think, 12 years at least. So I couldn't go anywhere. I was stuck here. So which means I really had to look at this island and look deep and walk. And I remember walking all the way down Katong towards Changi, just in order to get to know this terrible island that my parents ended up in. And the reason I said terrible, because it was flat, there were no hills. I grew up in Penang, and there was Penang Hill. And then in Malaysia, there was the main range. Every morning I opened my eyes, there was the mountain, and there was the huge blue sky. And Singapore suddenly seemed like the sky is pretty small. And eventually, as the government rules get tighter and tighter, the sky seems smaller and smaller. And the Singapore River became less wild and tame, and now it's a canal, and a beautiful one, of course, which you know, as visitors will enjoy. So that's part of my small eye in it. So in my writing, I explore these little margin ways of people trying to be Singaporeans. So in the River Song, the main character, Ping, is a musician. She thought she was Cantonese, but I think halfway through the novel, she discovered that her father was Indian. And then, but she, in her soul, she was Cantonese. So she wanted to be Cantonese, and she decided, I think someone said earlier on the panel this morning that identity is flexible. She decided she was Cantonese. And it's partly by a reflection of the author too. I am supposed to be Hokkien, but I was brought up by a maternal Cantonese grandmother, proud to be Cantonese, went to Cantonese kindergarten. So I decided I should be Cantonese.
I've never one moment doubted that I am the daughter of Singapore.
And I went through three national anthems, not anthems, but you know, I received the first message from the Queen of England when I was in primary school. Then we had to do the Garakum, and then we had to see Singapore. So whatever label that was defined as Singaporean, all the trappings that go around the identity making, is it a real or identity politicians, they have their own way of saying it, and all this with academics that define very theoretically. I am a mixed lot of all this, and I'm no apologies for it. When I met Constance earlier, and she said that we are the marginalized. I said, we are together as women, or maybe as ethnic group, we are further marginalized or at the edge. But for myself, being a Chinese, am I marginalized? You could say that I'm the ethnic privilege, and that is my main master identity. But when I travel around the region, I spend 5 months of my year in China. I am not the Chinese, and they don't accept me as Chinese either. They very literally see me as a Singaporean Chinese. I go to Hong Kong, they don't accept me as Chinese either. I am Hainanese Chinese, whereas they are Cantonese Chinese. And in Singapore, I speak to my Chinese friends. Many do not speak Chinese. So there wasn't that common foundation too. So what is that identity we're talking about, that Chinese name? So I throw that away like Suchen, I think in small I, how I identify as my identity as a daughter of Singapore, entitled to this land and all its entitlement and benefits, is a self-defining one. I don't think that identity is a snapshot and frozen in time or formulaic and given from top to down. It is a self-making, on the go, dynamic, fluid. It could be a daily in the making. So I think we live in a VUCA world, in a VUCA economics, we call it. And I think in our mindset, it's also very VUCA. If those who may not know what VUCA is, VUCA actually stands for volatility, uncertainty, complex, and ambiguous. And I think Singapore is very much in that social state of VUCAism. We are neither here nor there. We were told by the literary circle outside of Singapore that our English is substandard. We were told by the Chinese recently when it came to say that our Chinese is also substandard. Then we were told by the people in Taiwan about our Hokkien being totally unmelodious in the chorus. And we were told by the Hong Kong that Singapore Cantonese is really unpolished. So we are neither here nor there, we are quite confusing, but is there anything wrong with that? I think the vocal world has created a whole pool of possibility in its messiness, in its vagueness. So the response, therefore, as a Singaporean, is another vocal response. So what would that be? And I feel that may be a way I would define as uniquely Singapore. Versatility. I think we are very versatile. I can be in England, UK, hold a conference. I was recently in Asian Society in New York, and also I get an address in Columbia University, and I was even in West Point. And the Chinese that I met there, Asians that I met there, did not speak Chinese, did not know anything about Asia. They were all ABCs, and they had little knowledge of what's going on in the East. So the East-West dialogue really needed to be encouraged even among the diaspora Chinese. And my first leap into my recognition of my own identity at 23 years old was actually in Paris. I was put into a school, translation, and the blue-eyed French boy who came to ask me how about translation work on Chinese, he is so good in Chinese. So, in that sense, now I'm learning, you know, the versatility of Singaporean, that we can be in speaking English, we can speak in European language, we can speak in all the dialects. That's our uniqueness. We sometimes underestimate that powerful influence because that helps us operate around the region. The second response I would be is that unwavering perseverance to be that little red dot in this region. Every time I go to China, it was 10 years ago I do business development. Earlier days were very respectful to China, to Singapore. Now there's a certain elegance, you know. Your city state is 5 million. Our little village is about 12 million. There's a whole comparative side. It makes me realize how small we are, but it also means that I need to stand up and defend. And I always say to them, "小国大气," means little country, but big, big air, you know, big breath. And all the Singapore Inc. values and criteria I use them, that we are honest, that we are transparent, and that we are efficient, we are pragmatic, and all that. The third response for the VUCA was connectivity. And I feel that the small I in me, I see beyond Singapore as my home ground. I see the connectivity with someone in Europe, in America, in India. It's the connectivity that I create my universal village that defines me and the woman in me. And the last one was the vocal response will be the attitude. And I truly feel the making of the next Singapore identity is going to come from the women. Because one, we were marginalized before. Two, I think women have done 100 years of revolution in Singapore. I've written an essay on that. It's going to come out next week. Taking from my grandmother, I'm a third generation Singaporean Hainanese, and I think my family, I've benefited from 100 years of a silent revolution that had happened. And the women were once behind, and they were at the edge, and I think we're now going to take the ground. And because we had nothing that is formulated, we have that whole repertoire of possibilities of becoming. So we're not going to be ordered, it's going to be societal becoming the next wave of identity makers.
I want to ask you in a minute about what it means to you to be a woman in Singapore. But I'd like to ask you first, you both brought up the issue of language. And I find it curious, Suchen, you could write in Hokkien, is it? Or one of the Chinese...
I can't write in Chinese. You can't. So I want to ask you,
why have you chosen to write in English? Because language is what divides us very much in Singapore, and there are, to my mind at least, certainly not enough translation done and not enough good translation. There are many bad translations. So even as a nation, we can't really see into neighboring communities, different cultural communities. So I think more translation is needed. So I wanted to ask you why you chose to write in English. And Claire, who could write so ably in English, has written a biography, autobiography, and she's chosen to write it in Mandarin? Yeah. Not yet a translation. Which I found very irksome. I would love to read it. So can you just tell me why each of you has chosen to write in the language that you have? I know you've also written Claire in English, of course, but this large, thick autobiography and in Mandarin, I found curious. Yes?
One thing, I can't write in Chinese. I can understand Chinese. I can, in the sense of Cantonese, a little bit of Mandarin. It is by fluke or by accident and also by choice. First, when I was from age 3 to 5, I was in a Cantonese kindergarten learning the three character Confucians. Chinese classic, the three character classic. Yan Qi Chuo. How do you say it in Mandarin? Ren Zhi Chu, yes. Okay. After that, my mother was the head of her time, and I think quite a rebel in those days. My grandparents sent me to a Cantonese Confucius kindergarten, where my teacher wore a long robe, carried a fan, and I had to learn by repeating each page, and if I didn't know, you were knocked on the knuckles. and I had to write my Chinese characters with a brush and so on. But she decided that her daughter should go to an English school, to the convent, CH, Convent of the Holy Infant Jesus, run by the Irish nuns. And she queued up to send me there. And miraculously, somehow I was accepted. And there I found a strange world, a world that cut me off. I had to, the moment I crossed the gate, I had to shed whatever I had. See, in my head, from the time I was born to age six, my head was filled with Monkey King from Journey to the West, from, filled with the fairies from China, Guan Yin, you know, and all the Kung Fu masters and so on, you know, and Lotus Boy, and I don't know, all the gods, all the whole pantheon of Chinese gods. But when I went into the convent, I saw all these nuns in white and black, speaking to me a tongue that I could not understand. Even my mother could not understand. And then suddenly, I had to relearn everything. I wasn't stupid, but for 3 years, I felt like a stupid and dumb kid. But because in that school, they kept on reading fairy tales to us, slowly, my head was filled with Humpty Dumpty and Snow White and Rose Red and all that. And eventually, because my mother was so strict, I too rebelled against her and decided to turn to all these angels and saints and so on in order to fight against her Chinese gods. So in my head, there was a great big battle between Michael the Archangel and, Lord Cha, the Lotus Boy, okay? And whenever she punished me, I would seek help from the other side. My punishment was always to kneel under the coffee table when I kneel. My head would just touch there, and the tablecloth would cover me. So I could eavesdrop onto the women's conversation in the afternoon. Oh, somebody said she was an excellent eavesdropper. So was I, from age six right through to age eight. I could eavesdrop on all those afternoon stories and gossip that my aunts and my mother would tell each other. Who went with who bed with who was the mistress, who was the concubine, and things like that, And I even tried to spy on my father, who was doing some hanky-panky. So that was really good training for a writer. Eventually, I was the only daughter, and my mother, being a nosy Parker, would like to read, daughters' diaries and things and so on. So writing in English kept her out. So that was my main reason I told my publisher why I wrote in English. It spurred me on to carry on writing in English.
I grew up in a very multicultural neighborhood. I grew up in Little India. In fact, my first uncles and aunties, whom I call uncles and aunties, are Indians. And my first mentor was actually Miss Govindasamy, my primary one school teacher, who taught me how to write. So for a long time, English was quite that sort of official language in the household, but between parents, we speak Hainanese, and in the whole area that I live in Little India, there was also the Malay community. So truly, I was exposed to a number of languages. So I think that, again, it's unique in Singapore that we all speak a spectrum of 10 dialects. Not all well, but enough to be sensitive to it. My mother, I went to a Chinese school, I started with one. And then, of course, we all felt that learning Chinese, you're not going to get a job. Out of panic, my mother pulled me out from Nanhua at primary three and made me go back to start school again for primary one in Raffles because that we are getting a job. So English and Chinese always been the two languages I've operated in, but although I went to Raffles, I went back to the Chinese school for dance. So I feel I'm always at the edge. So I don't think language alone defines your core or master identity, because I am comfortable in two circles, and I have two circles of friends, locally and internationally. Why did I, which one I'm more comfortable with? Different. I kind of find some switch. When I go to Chinese chamber, with all the donkeys and upbeat in Chinese speaking, I am in a different mindset. When I go to China, I adopt a certain Chinese language, again, different mindset. So that flexible ability or flexible citizenship is another, I feel, a Singapore plus. The reason for writing my autobiography in Chinese, and that happened, I could not celebrate my 60th birthday because I lost my mother-in-law then, who was a creative writer. I don't pretend to be a creative writer. My autobiography was really my attempt to put a legacy in place for my children. It's to document and record six chapters of my life and of being and becoming and also to do the work for the children so they don't have to ask me too much about my history and got it if anything happens to me. The person that spurred me on to put this together was my co-writer, Pan Xinhua. So we were actually putting a record of my stories because she had followed me for 25 years in her journalism and felt that the few things there that could, should be shared, especially being a woman person at the edge. At the edge in neighborhoods, because I stayed in, I lived in an Indian neighborhood and a Malay neighborhood, the being in two streams at the edge of the language, operating always in two cultures, Chinese chamber and then with aware and the others, it's always at the edge. And then now Singapore, China, at the edge. And I was doing my master's in Hong Kong, so I was always at the edge. And I used to feel that I didn't belong. But in fact, I felt that was actually the strength and opportunity. So it was Xinhua, who is totally Chinese in her mindset and thinking, felt that, you know, I should put it down. So two of us collaborated. And what we did was I put all my writing on the desk, and she did about 6 hours of interviews with me, and we both are full-time workers, so I mean, we work only at night. So I will write, she will write, and then we edit each other, and then we put that together in 5 months. There are certain times when I count in Hainanese, I still do that. When I reflect on certain emotional moments, it's always in Chinese. There are some moments it's in Cantonese because I lived 4 years in Hong Kong. So I am going through the translation of my book in Chinese to English. It was a tremendous challenge because the publisher who translated it, I rejected it last year. It would have been, I was trying to publish it. And I suddenly remember language as a tool doesn't quite reflect the host of sentiments that define me. And I had to reject that, but it wasn't my voice, it wasn't the way I would phrase it. So now I'm working with another publisher in England to see how to work that to reflect a better story. So it is not it's not that I chose it to write in English or in Chinese. It's just a circumstance, actually. I had somebody who worked with me on it. And when I did Stepping Out, that was entirely an academic book. And that experience had made me vow never to write an academic book again. It took me 4 years. It went through a jury. It was published by Prentice Hall, Simon Schuster. And I went through a viva of like, you know, 1,000 questions and a panel of inquiries and all that. It was painful. It was painful, and it was also so academic that it lost a lot of what I felt in creative writing, that soul, that stretch of imagination. Because I had to verify source, comma, full stop, etc., and the whole theoretical structure, and the rationale, and the explanatory framework, etc. No, I wouldn't want to do that again.
I'd like to say something about writing in English. I think in Singapore, it is, in a way, because is it Liu Yi? They bring back colonial rule or something? It is because of colonial rule that English came into being. And whether we agree with the with the policy of using English as our new language or not. I think it makes fiction and poetry in English, literature in English, accessible to a whole lot of Singaporeans. Whereas if you were to write only in Tamil, or in Malay, or in Chinese, then it's only accessible to your own community. And that's one of the things. And it gives us, you know, and English has this plasticity. I have tried to use it to reflect non-educated dialect speakers in my fiction. And I know that some, I think of in Cantonese, sometimes in Hokkien, like you, depending on my characters, and then I have to do a translation. So that is important for us here. I'm not sure whether it's important elsewhere.
We have just 2 minutes left, but I just want to ask you briefly. I have deep admiration for Singaporean women, and I think Singaporean women have gone with such rapidity, if I put it very simplistically, from bound feet to boardroom in a very short period of time. I wonder, in your novel, A Bit of Earth, Suchen, there's a passage that stays with me still about a village woman being abused by the whole village because she's trespassed in some way. And Claire, you've trod the journey of your own family's women through 3 generations. What do you feel? What have you learned from those journeys you've taken with women of the past compared to your situation as women of Singapore today?
Well, I think women with boundaries are strong, okay, for one. And there were also women, Chinese women, without bound feet, who deliberately chose not to have their feet bound. And that was a very courageous move in those days. And because of these strong women, they have taught us, in turn, to be strong. So I think I grew up with lots of strong women who did business, who made decisions, who ran away with the men they loved, you know, and so on, who were against their families, and who married out of their own ethnic group. You know, I have a sister-in-law married to Muslim, you know, created a whole lot of problem. But now, for Christmas, we have satay, and we have turkey, and we have Christmas pudding.
I think the problems of women, whether it is ranging from domestic violence to trafficking, will always be there. Centuries ago, they now is still there. It's in different forms and done in sometimes very sophisticated way too. So I want to deal with that. There's a lot more work that needs to be done. I said earlier that I think the women is going to take their gender because they were at the back room and then now they're at edge and now they can take the ground. Because I think we have been the change makers and we are forced to change. And the whole globalization and the labor situation made us made it possible because of economic independence. Therefore, I feel that that identity in the making for women, as I see in some of the 30-year-olds today, those 30 years old who were born after the 80s and 90s, they speak quite a different language. They will say, I do not want to work 9 to 5, and if I do, it's on my terms, and these are my terms. And if you don't get those terms, they decided to be their own bosses. And I've seen so many of them becoming their own bosses, which I applaud, which I recommend, because that is a real challenge to the whole capitalist system, which is very genderized. That's why women are now fixing their gender in the workplace to ask for work-life flexibility, work-life integration, with paternity leave, longer one and longer maternity leave. So I think we are defining their gender, which in the end will reflect our own women's identity, which is good.
Thank you very much, Claire.